Hi all, this is Mina and welcome to my channel. I'm excited about today's video because it is the first video I'm making on how to extract data from source systems, transform them, and load into SQL Server. This ETL process will be completed using SSIS. For this tutorial, I obtained preliminary data set on confirmed cases of COVID-19 from the Statistics Canada website. And here is the link for you to get the data set as well. At the end of this video, you will be able to understand the purpose of staging environment, drawing data modeling and data warehousing design process. You will be able to migrate data from source systems into staging environments using SSIS. SSIS simply stands for SQL Server Integration Services. And the third objective will be to help you create source to target mapping document that you can use to track all of your ETL processes. You would also be able to create an enterprise data warehouse task schema in SQL Server based on the Ralph Campbell methodology. And lastly, you would have a data warehouse that is populated with data from staging environment to the data warehouse using SSIS. Before we move on to explore the data, I would like to walk you through a brief introduction to what data warehouse is all about and what is ETL. So as you all know, we have data from several different sources. And in order for us to get it into a central data warehouse, we need to grab all of the data from wherever they are situated, whether on the cloud or on our local computer. We need to extract that data, transform it, and then load it into a temporary environment. Here in this case, it's referred to as staging database. So that's a temporary environment that holds the data, and then from there, you can again extract the data from the staging environment, transform it, and load into the data warehouse. Once in the data warehouse, business users can explore the data and create visualizations and reports on it using Power BI, Tableau, Excel, or SSRS. In some companies, they prefer to rather create a data mart, which is a simple form of data warehouse focused for just a single department. So let's say they would create a data mart from the data warehouse just for the sales department. So that would contain only sales information, and the sales guys can develop reports from it. And also they can create another one for the HR to also report on that as well. They can have several different data marts, but you can also find most of the time business users going directly into the data warehouse to create reports as well. So moving on to explore our data set. I got this data set from the Statistics Canada website, as I've already talked about. And here is the definition of all of the columns. They did so well to define all of the columns on the metadata sheet. And we have about 29 columns in that table. It's basically about COVID-19 patients and whether they were hospitalized or not, the week in which they started experiencing symptoms, and if their symptoms or their infection led to death or not. It also records the year that the incident happened, and also a little bit of personal information regarding the patient, such as the gender and the age group of the patient. So this is the metadata, and this is the data itself, 29 columns. So from this data, I created a source to target mapping document. If you watch my previous video on how to create dimensional data model, I showed you how to create a source to target mapping document, which is essentially metadata that you can use to track all of your source tables, source columns, all the way through the ETL process. So you can use it to keep track of your source tables and the tables and columns that end up in the staging environment, as well as the tables and columns that you will specify as your dimensions when you are creating the data warehouse, as well as the fact information. So from this source to target mapping document, I have a column called source system. So here I specify where the file is located on my local computer. If it's in the cloud, you can put that information under the source system or database here. And the source table within this location is called the COVID-19 data. These are the different columns in the table that I showed you previously. So from this source data, I'm going to create a staging environment, which is essentially a database table. You can see a database table within SQL Server, and I'm going to call that table COVID-19. And the columns, I'm going to have to rename all of these columns into meaningful column names. And I'm going to perform a little bit of transformation on some of the columns. So I have modified the data a little bit so that we can transform it. So if you look in the data, I have removed the vet field as well as the transmission field. I want to use SSIS to migrate all of the source data into the SQL Server staging environment. And I'm going to use SSIS to change all of the column names, as well as introduce these two new columns that I've intentionally omitted from the source data. So this is going to be how I'm going to structure the Star Schema Enterprise Data Warehouse. And from all of these columns, I've been able to identify 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'll say 6 dimensions from the source system. So I identify the dimension called region, which is essentially containing all the region or the location of the COVID-19 patient. And in this table, I'm just going to have the region code and the definition of the region itself. And because this is a dimension table, I'm going to introduce a surrogate key, which is an auto-incrementing identity primary key field. Auto-incrementing means that I'm going to set it to start from 1 and increment by 1. So in this field, I'm just going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it's a primary key because it will uniquely identify all of the region information within that table. All right. And I'm also going to have the year week table. This is a little different from our typical dimension that we know, because the data was collected at the weekly level. So that is the grain of the data. So it's aggregated to week level, and I do not have granular information as to the day, the minute or the hour the incident occurred. So I'm also going to create a year week table that has just the year and the week. So in this table, I would create a year week ID field, which will essentially be a combination of these two fields, and that's going to be my primary key. There is also the dim patient details table, and that has all of the personal information regarding the patient, such as the gender and the age group and the occupation of the patient. In this table, I'm going to create a patient ID field to serve as my primary or surrogate key. And this is auto-incremented as well. All of my primary keys will be auto-incremented. All right, there is the dim transmission table that would contain the transmission code, which is more like a business key. Business key means that it's just a code. So if we go into the metadata, let me show you. Transmission code So it's just like one stands for domestic acquisition contact of COVID-19 case, and then two, so it's just 129 in that field. And the transmission is the description of the code. However, I'm still going to have a surrogate or primary key to uniquely identify this field in case the code. We usually create this primary key so that in case the business key or the code information changes, it does not affect the uniqueness of our field. All right. There is also the DIM hospital status table that will contain the hospital status code and the hospital status. And hospital status ID field will be the primary key. I'm going to put asymptomatic resolved death information into the junk table because all of them contain yes and no. I'm not going to create three tables here. I'm going to create just one. And then I would create a role-playing dimension that would link them to the fact table. And this will be the primary key of this table. And moving on to the fact information, this COVID ID field is coming from the source. So that will serve as my business key. So in that case, I need to create a primary surrogate key, which I will call fact COVID-19 underscore ID. And then a typical fact table needs to have the foreign keys of all the associated dimensions, which means that all of the primary keys within these tables need to also be represented in the fact table so that they can the connections can be created between the dimensions in the fact table. I do not have any metric information in this fact table, so that renders this fact table as a factless fact table. This is the name for a fact table that does not have any metric information in it. In all of these columns, there is no column that serves as a degenerate dimension. So in this fact table, there will be no degenerate dimension. Last but not the least, I will introduce a load date field to serve as a date stamp for when the records are loaded into my fact table. So here I'm going to just draw a logical model for you to get an overview of how the star schema is going to look like. So this is going to be my fact table in the center and the dimension tables surrounding it. So I'm just drawing the logical model so you can have an idea of how the star schema and data warehouse is going to look like. So I like to represent everything in the form of a diagram. So here we go, region linking to the fact table. And the way they can link to the fact table is when I introduce their IDs or primary keys into the fact table here. So because I have region ID here and region ID here, I can link both tables. All right, and last but not least, this is how our star schema is going to look like. And for the junk table, I'm going to have three connections to the fact table. Yes, each one representing asymptomatic, resolved, and death information. All right, let me know in the comment section if you have any questions regarding this model And since I'll be covering a lot of topics in this video, please feel free to pause the video to gain more clarity on anything you might miss along the way. Also, due to high level of questions from my viewers, I now have a dedicated team who will answer all your practical questions and also offer mentorship on these topics. So if you are interested, feel free to send us an email. So right now we are going to move on to Visual Studio and we are going to create new project using the Integration Service project. That's SSIS, SQL Server Integration Services. In Visual Studio, you can identify it as Integration Service Project. So I'll click on that and go to Next. Now I have to give a name to my project. I'm going to call it COVID-19 ETL. Okay. I need to save this in my C drive. So I'm just gonna navigate to my C drive and save it in this folder. Now I can click on create. And this begins my ETL creation process.